5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. They would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to notice in its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister looking. You know, the look it was giving me.
What are you reporting?
Jesus Christ, you better...
Sure.
See ya.
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Bigfoot Hotspot Radio, Sasquatch Chronicles. I'm your host, Wes, along with my brother, Woody, and researcher, author, and friend, William Jeffy. Let's start the show. Episode 45. God, I can't believe we're on episode 45. I want to apologize to everyone last week for the hiatus we took last week off. But we're definitely back this week. I know before we actually get started, Will, you wanted to give a quick shout-out to a listener.
I want to give a shout-out to Michael DiLorenzo, who is a fan of the show, and sent a very nice email. Mike, I hope everything is all well with you, and, you know, stay in touch, buddy.
Yeah, it was a nice email, and I don't want to go into what was actually in the email, but I want to thank Mike for the email too as well. It was very genuine, very heartfelt, and just thanks, Mike. It kind of makes things worthwhile when you get emails like that. So thank you very much for taking the time to send that to us, and thanks for listening too, by the way. I also want to thank Jay Frazier. He had sent us an email about the last show. We were talking a lot about if these creatures can actually, the difference between language and actually them mimicking what we're saying. And he brought up a great point about parrots. You know, that a parrot can mimic what you say. It's not like you can sit and have a conversation with a parrot, but a parrot can bring up it. Anyway, it was a long email, a lot of great points. So thank you, Jay, for sending that to us. And just one last shout out I want to give before we get to the show and give the people what they want. I wanted to thank Chad. Chad had sent us a private message on Facebook, and it was a video clip of this teacher, Mr. K. I believe it was in West Virginia, but Mr. K was actually sitting in front of his class explaining to them how he had actually run into a Sasquatch when he was a child. And I thought the whole thing was just a real fascinating story. I posted it up on our Facebook page. If you go to Bigfoot Hotspot Radio, the fan page on Facebook, you can see it. He has a lot of patients sitting there with the kids because they were kind of interrupting him. But his story was very fascinating, and he talked a little bit about the Minnesota Iceman. So the whole thing was just, it was awesome. Thank you, Chad, for sending that over to us. I know we have a great show tonight. I know everyone's looking forward to it.
Yeah, it sounds like a really interesting. I'm interesting one. I'm really looking forward to the one guest that we talked about earlier.
Yeah, let's go ahead and bring the guest on. Tonight on the show, we have Jack from Washington State. And Jack's actually in law enforcement. He's an ex-special forces. He spent a lot of time in the military. And tonight, we are going to see if we can get him to talk a little bit about some encounters that he has heard through some of his special forces friends where they encountered these creatures here in the States and had to, I guess for lack of a better word, take care of them, deal with them, different situations. So it should be a real fascinating show, but I wanted to welcome Jack to the show.
Hey, how are you?
Hey, good. How are you doing, Jack?
Oh, not too bad.
I wanted to welcome you to the show, Jack. And before we actually get into your encounter and your experiences in the military through your special forces contact, would you mind by starting off by telling us about your brother's encounter with the camper and kind of what happened to your brother?
Yeah, sure. This is back in 1997. And my younger brother was stationed at Fort Lewis. Basically, what had happened was he was trying to get the last couple of days in of elk season, him and his buddy. So they went to Mount Rainier, set up their camp, and they were over on the east side of the mountain. They go set their camp up, and then they go check out where they're going to go hunting, you know, kind of try to scout out some sites. Well, when they got back to their camp was totally destroyed. The tent was tore up. Cooler was turned over. I mean, when I say it was destroyed from what he told me. So they kind of cleaned it up, and they're thinking, well, crap, it's a bear, you know. So they go down to the whatever closest town that they were at. They get something to eat, and then they get back up there, and they decide they're going to sleep in the back of the pickup. They had a camper shell on the back of my little brother's pickup. You know, military sleeping bags aren't, they're roomy for one person, and the person that's in it, that's it. And you're kind of cocooned like an old mummy. Tyler kind of said that he woke up about, like 3:30 in the morning. Couldn't figure out why he just kind of woke up. And he's kind of looking around and had this 44 Magnum he used to carry with him all the time. And to understand my little brother is not a very tall man. He's only like 5'6". So he's got little man syndrome bad. So his attitude is the bigger the caliber, the better he likes the gun. So anyways, he's looking for this pistol of his. And he's got this little angle head flashlight, and he's flashing around, and all of a sudden he looks at the window closest to him, the side window, and there's this face looking at him. And he said it was totally human. It looked like a normal human face, only at a bigger scale. And he said, and I didn't see much of the face except for from about mid-chin up to about, you know, just above the eyebrow. He didn't say how long he was looking at it, but he said all of a sudden the thing bared its teeth at him. And, you know, my kid brother's not, he's not one to exaggerate. And he goes, dude, this thing had canines that were every bit of 3.5 inches long. And I said, what? He goes, yeah, it had canines. And he said, I'm thinking a bear at first. And he said, no, bears don't have a human nose. Their eyes are a little bit offset to their side of their head, not like an elephant or a horse, but they're a little bit offset. And he said, but this was like a human face. And all of a sudden it started to rock the truck back and forth and started collapsing the camper shell down on top of him and his buddy. He's, hey, you need to wake up. You need to wake up. And his buddy's like, I'm awake, but I ain't moving. Well, this lasted, Tyler said it lasted a good long time, and finally they realized the camper shell's collapsing down on top of them. And the thing would walk around the truck, beating on his truck, you know, like it hit it with its hand. About sunup, he said it had settled down. They hadn't seen it past the back glass for a while. That's when he looked at his watch and he said, you know, at 6:30, they realized the thing had left. So they kicked open the back glass. They got out of the truck, threw what they had left of the cooler in the truck, got in their truck, and they left. You know, my kid brother's not one to put on tails. I could tell that he was scared. He showed me pictures of the truck when he went and had the claim for insurance. He's like, what am I going to tell them? That Sasquatch, beat down the roof of my camper shell in my pickup? I'd never gotten paid for it. So he said, it was a bear. As far as the insurance is concerned, it was a bear. It was a big grizzly bear. I ribbed him for it for a while, and I got to thinking about it. So, the more I think about it, the more when I think about when Tyler told me in person that it was, he was scared. He was absolutely scared. And not a whole lot scares him. But, boy, this scared him. And you could tell it. You could see it in his face.
It's interesting that he took note of the canines. You know, we've heard a lot of different encounters where witnesses report that Sasquatch shows their teeth, and then there's these canines. It's pretty rare, but we do hear of it. What do you think, Jack? Why do you think the creature went off the way it did?
You know, I think he was in an area he probably wasn't supposed to be in. Whatever it was, even my own experience, whatever it is, I don't think it likes humans in close proximity to where it is either feeding or living.
Yeah, they generally don't like human presence at all, actually.
No, and that's the thing is that he didn't mention the color of his eyes. He said it had pretty good sized eyes. They were more almond shaped than anything. But he said it really. He said when he looked in its face, and all of a sudden it bared its teeth at him. And he said the one thing that jumped out at me right off the bat, he said it had larger than normal teeth, like the incisors and the eye teeth. He said, but the canines were pronounced, not to the point of. He said, you know how a baboon's got exceptionally large canines? I'm like, yeah. And he goes, it wasn't like that. It was more like. It was like a gorilla or a chimpanzee's canines that are a little bit longer than the normal tooth, but you could tell that it was a canine.
You know, that's a detail that's not often talked about with people. I've heard plenty of stories, where people say they saw the canines, and it always reminds me back of the old Teddy Roosevelt account in his 1892 book, Wilderness Hunter, and where one of the trappers was killed. And the story related stated that there were four great fang marks in the back of the guy's neck who was killed. So really, those accounts of that sort of thing go way, way back.
My own account, which, I'm originally from South Texas, happened just west of Fort Worth in 82, and it was actually in July of 82. The year prior, we'd just gotten over a real bad drought. In 81, towards the end of 81, well, come the summer of 82, we started getting some good rains. And, my dad was having problems with my stepmother. And he said, I got a plethora of brothers. I got 10 brothers. My dad, since me and my younger brother, Jerry, were still left at the house that were, below 15 years of age. He's like, you want to go visit your Aunt Dorothy? Sure. That sounds like fun. Beats the hell out of picking stalls and feeding cows every day in the summertime or mowing lawn, you bet. So we go up to just outside of Fort Worth, and we're actually at Lone Star Lake where my aunt lived. Went and visited my kinfolk there and my cousin Forrest, which is my Aunt Dorothy's boy. We all decided one night we're going to go get frogs. So we're walking from his house, and the main road that goes past the road that shoots straight to the dam, which is where we were going to go get frogs, well, right there where the dam road dead ends right into a general store on that main road. Well, we go past the general store and get on the main road going into the dam, and there's several pastures kind of lining this road. And the first pasture on the left-hand side was a big peach orchard. It was about 15, 20 acres. It wasn't terribly big, but it was big enough. And the next pasture after that was a was a hay field, and the same way on the other side was all hay fields or just cow pastures. Well, we get just, the dam's not, but maybe a quarter of a mile down the road from the general store. And we get halfway there, and we hit this pasture that's got all these cattle in it, and we see them bucking and playing and carrying on. And this is like middle of the night. And we're like, what the hell's wrong with those cows? You know, this is kind of unusual. My brother, Gary Lee, is the one that actually noticed it right off the bat. And all of a sudden, my cousin Forrest goes, what's that? And I'm looking at my cousin Forrest like, what do you mean, what's that? And he's pointing. Well, directly across from the pasture, there was another pasture, but outside the pasture was this big pond tree. I kind of, as I'm turning and looking, I'm looking at Gary Lee, and he's starting to cry, and he said, we need to go. Well, I look, and there's something crouching, and it looked like a man crouching. Well, God knows how long we stood there looking at it, and all of a sudden it stood up, and Gary Lee's bawling up a storm, and I kind of turn around, look back at him a little bit, trying to keep my eye on this thing, and I'm like, what the hell's the matter with you, dude? And he's like, we need to go. And the thing walked out in the middle of the road. The one thing that hit us right off the bat was when we got to that pasture, we'd smelled something bad, but that wasn't unusual because the water table was so low at the dam and was slowly creeping back up. You could smell, you know, decaying vegetation and stuff. So that wasn't an unusual trait to smell a bad smell close to the dam. But now that I've gotten older and had a lot of time to think about it, I think it was this thing that we smelt right off the bat. Well, as it walked out in the middle of the road, my brother Gary Lee grabs my arm. He goes, we need to go now. And he's really starting to have a real fit. And of course, I'm like, well, whatever you do, don't turn your back and start running. We're just going to walk backwards. Well, the thing follows us right down the middle of the road. And we walk all the way backwards till we get about 300 feet from the general store. And the general store had a big street light out in front of it, old country street light. Well, the thing turned to our left, its right. This road's a normal road. It's about 18 feet wide. One step off the road, and it was into the bar ditch. The next step, it was right up to the fence. If it didn't jump the fence, stepped over it. And it took off. And what kind of grabbed us was this thing was huge. And when I mean huge, it was like 8.5 feet tall. And it was about 4 foot at the shoulders. And we didn't notice the neck. It was kind of hunched over. The whole time it walked, it didn't straighten up like a man would walk. It was a little hunched over at the waist. It was bent at the knees. The arms were, I'd say, about mid-thigh. Just a little bit past mid-thigh, and it was just huge. Now, could we see details? No, we had enough that we could see hair. We had enough ambient light from the moon that we could tell that it was big. But we didn't see any eye shine. We didn't have flashlights. We could just tell that this thing was just huge, and it was hairy. Well, when it went through that peach orchard, I mean, in no time, I mean, just most Ricky Tick. It was from one end of the peach orchard to the other, and it was just almost like a blink of an eye. It was on the other side, and this was a rather tangular, long peach orchard. It didn't have but maybe four rows of trees, but they went about the whole length of that orchard. As soon as it got into that field and started running, and it ran like a man, we turned around, we hauled butt to that general store. And my cousin Forrest is beating on the door. Well, he knew the people that owned the store. And an old man answered it. And I can't remember the old man's name. He's, hey, I need to get, we need to use your phone. We need to get out of here. We get in there, and the old man let us use the phone. My cousin Forrest calls my Aunt Dorothy. Rather short period of time, my Aunt Dorothy shows up, picks us up. As we're driving home, she asks us what happened. We told her. And she's like, all right, y'all just had a bad night. Somebody's messed with me. Go to bed. So we go to bed. I know for a fact my brother Jerry had nightmares after that for months. I didn't go to sleep right away because I just in my mind's eye, I kept seeing this huge mass right in front of us. I don't know how well my cousin Forrest slept, but I don't think he slept all that well. Next morning, we get up about 10:30. It was my aunt was a ER nurse, so it was her night off, and we get up, and she's like, "What did you boys see again last night?" And we told her the whole thing, start to finish. And she's like, "Okay, well, the sheriff's office called. They heard that you went to the general store last night in the middle of the night to call me. They want to talk to you boys." She calls the sheriff's office. Deputy comes out in a very short period of time, asks us what happened. We told him. He goes, "Okay, well, here's the deal, boys. They found, I think it was four or five dead cows in that pasture. One had its throat ripped out. All of them had been disemboweled. The rest of them had broke legs. So they're thinking that either somebody's, you know, doing some kind of ritualistic killing, or, you know, it was a coyote attack, which isn't unusual. It's kind of unusual that a coyote would attack like that, but what made it really unusual is coyotes don't break legs. And these were, from what the deputy told us, these were upper leg breaks. These were like hip bone type breaks. These weren't lower leg breaks. You know, from that point on, my aunt didn't let us leave the house. You know, we had to be in the house at 9 o'clock. A couple weeks pass, and my dad comes and picks us up. We tell her this. He's like, "Okay, yeah, the booger man acted." Well, we hadn't been home a week, and my aunt calls. And she's talking to my dad, and my dad gets off the phone, and he calls me and my brother Jerry into the kitchen. He goes, "Your Aunt Dorothy's moving back." "Oh, wow, cool. Why?" "Well, she was on call last night. She was the ER nurse. She was on her rounds, and they brought this woman in that was in hysterics. And shortly thereafter, they brought her son in, and he was pretty well tore up. You know, his feet were pretty well tore up." Well, what the story was with that was, from what she told my dad, is that this woman and her 5-year-old little boy were driving down on the other side of where we were, past the dam, and her car breaks down. And so they're not that far from Lone Star, which is the closest town, not but maybe 3 miles outside of the city limits. So they decided, well, why wait? We'll just go ahead and walk into town. Well, as they're walking into town, something started chasing them. And apparently the deputy that found her had actually seen the car with the hazard lights on, went looking around, didn't find anybody there, so he continues on. And then all of a sudden he comes across this woman laying on the side of the road, and he stops, and she's in hysterics. "Whatever it is, it's after us. It's trying to get my little boy. It's trying to get my little boy." Well, he finally calms her down, gets her in the patrol unit, and they call EMS, and they show up. And, apparently, they finally find the little boy, and he was in a culvert that went across underneath the road. And when they finally got him out of there, he kept saying, "The monster's trying to get me. He was trying to get me. He was trying to pull me out of the culvert." So whatever it was, in this woman's description of what she had saw was, it was big, it was hairy, and it was chasing. And she ended up with a broke rib, I think, if memory serves me right. She had a broken rib. But that little boy, my aunt said, that little boy's lower legs and his feet were tore up. Whatever it was, tried pulling him out.
Were there any more stories after that from that area, do you know of, or?
Well, shortly thereafter, like within just a couple of weeks, my aunt and my cousin Forrest had moved back to, you know, South Texas, just west of San Antonio, where I'm originally from. I'd heard here later on in life, I was a cop in the Dallas area, and I'd heard later on in life that there, that whole area from just west of Fort Worth, clear over into Greenville, has always been had a intermittent problem with some kind of that they call, you know, I'm from the South. We call them boogers. We, you know, that you talk to the old people, and you, you got to be careful. There are boogers around here. Well, you know, when you're a kid growing up in South Texas, what the hell's a damn booger? You know, are you talking about a, you know, booger at your nose, or, you know, well, what they mean by booger is I got a brother that lives in St. Augustine, Texas, which is just east of Lufkin, south of Nacogdoches, in north of Hemphill. When you talk about boogers there, they're serious, and they're dead serious. And they don't, you hear them scream, you don't leave the house. You need to stay in the house. Now, my older brother had never had any problems with them, but you know, when I go visit, every now and again you get one of those old black gentlemen that live on the outskirts of Pine View or there's a botanical gardens down in the Sabine River Basin, just on the Texas side, across the reservoir from Toledo Bend. And you talk to the little black gentleman down there, and they'll tell you some real spooky stories about, you know, having run-ins with these things. That was pretty much my start of trying to, you know, figure out what the hell I saw, and tried to get all the information I could. And then, of course, when I joined the military, I started out in combat arms and went off into special forces. I had a kind of a semi, oh, what's the best way to put it? Unpleasant encounter with a current that wrote a book, and he was talking about, you know, he didn't understand why special forces were used in some of these missing people situations in national parks, and why would they be off by themselves in their own little world? Well, the Special Forces, being a former 18 Bravo, Special Forces is very unique. And there are teams within Special Forces that actually specialize in tracking. And there's a school in Malaysia, it's called Malaysian Tracker School, that the U.S. government will send Special Forces, Rangers or Green Berets, if they want to go, or even Delta. And I cannot confirm or deny whether or not Delta exists. Hint, hint, wink, wink. We'll leave it at that.
Yeah, I'm a former 19 Delta. Got a letter from the Sergeant Major of Delta back in 1980, so I know they're there.
Yeah, they're there. So, you know, they go through this school. I never went through it, but I knew guys, and I had served with guys that actually had gone through these specialized schools, like Malaysian Tracker School. These guys could track a flea in a blizzard and tell you exactly where they started and where they ended up. But that's like anything else in the military, especially like marksmanship. It's a perishable skill. So if you don't exercise it, you lose it. So they take these opportunities. Now, an MOR, Memorandum for Record, is generated through either the Forestry Service or the Department of Interior and sent up to Department of the Army, requesting assistance in this area. Now, this is where it becomes a little unique. That's just one aspect. I served with a guy that was in second group at Lewis. I served with him at fifth group at Campbell. We'd served together in Somalia. He was part of the operations in when the Rangers got hit in Mogadishu. He was one of the guys that ended up going in after the Rangers. And he, one night, when he was at fifth group with me, we're all sitting in the buddy's house just outside of Fort Campbell, and he starts talking about this mission that he did. And at first I'm like, okay, here we go. We got one of these fishing stories, and he caught a minnow, and it's going to be Moby Dick or Jaws. No, that isn't what it was. Talk about that when he was at Lewis, he ended up getting called in, him and his team, and he had just gotten in to Delta. Team got called in for this. Basically, they'd had a problem. They needed to hunt this animal down and get rid of it. When my buddy started telling me what it was that they were hunting, that's when I started paying attention to him. I'm like, okay, what does this thing look like? And he's like, it's bigger than anything you ever, it'll make you question what you know is real and what you know isn't real. The thing's enormous. It's super aggressive, super powerful. Part of the safety briefing prior to going out on this mission was, do not let it get a hold of you. If you get close enough to where it can snag you, that's it. There's nothing we can do. You can't even break free from it. It'll rip you apart. And he started talking about how they were going through Mount Hood area and, you know, through these valleys and down into these gulches. And they finally, it was like a pack of three of them, and they had run off the rest of them. They had finally got them scared off and got this one cornered. And this thing was just enormous. And he said nothing, and the Army prepares you for a lot of stuff. He said, as you well know. He said, but it doesn't prepare you for anything like this. When you start questioning what you think you know is really in the woods and what isn't in the woods, he said after that, I put total faith in my equipment and my weapons. He said, they bleed like we do. They die like we do. But they don't fight like we do. He said, we went out as a 12-man team. And he had later found out that they had had other instances where they had had to hunt these animals down. And when he described it, he's like, had human features, but it was extremely well built. He said, there wasn't an ounce of fat on this animal anywhere. They're not built like we are, where we have these big major lats, you know, in our rib cage, part of our muscle grouping. No, all the muscles in the rib cage are massive. The whole chest area is massive. They got bigger eyes than we got. The human nose, which is proportionate to the size of the skull it's got. He said, there's no neck. And he said, it's a little bit longer arm length than what you would expect a human. But he said, they're incredibly fast. He said, you would be amazed at how fast these things are. And they can cover massive amounts of ground in a very short period of time. Well, I know that to be true from my own experience. He said, when they got it cornered, he said, we lit it up, and that was it. And then, he went on to say, you know, they called in a Chinook, put it in a sling load netting, and got it out of there, and didn't have any more trouble after that. But he said, it's not unusual for us to get called in for that. And he said, and that was the one thing that more than anything prepared me for combat. He said, being around a human being doesn't scare me. He said, that scares me. Because in your own mind, you're rationalizing that this isn't a real thing, but it's right in front of you. It wants to hurt you. And he said, and you get them cornered, they'll pick up rocks. You swear to God that there's no way that thing could pick that rock up. And they can throw it a pretty good distance. And these are boulders, not just rocks, boulders. He said from his experience that he knew that they do use some rudimentary tools. They have been known to use sticks to fight with when they cornered this beast. And he said it was taller than anybody that we were there. And this man's not a small man. This man's, you know, like 6'5". This dude's a racehorse. And what I mean by a racehorse, he'd run 15 miles a day when I was in group with him. He didn't, there was no ifs, ands, or buts.
I find the story fascinating for a couple reasons. All of us know members of Special Forces. And Special Forces members don't need a Bigfoot story to impress you. They already have, I mean, they could sit down and tell you story after story after story. That's impressive. They don't need a Bigfoot story to impress anyone. But I think it's a very fascinating story, and it gives a lot of insight to, and I know Woody and Will, you guys will agree with me on this, a lot of what Jack's talking about is a lot of things that Mr. Black has also talked to us about.
we have a guy who's a government insider that gives us little pieces of information because he has to protect his identity. And he has a lot of knowledge about the military and other agencies dealing with these creatures back to the 70s. And, it sounds exactly like, and who the guest we had on a couple weeks ago who had the story about, wasn't that the Dakotas where the sheriff's department and the military, I think it was military, or whoever they were from the government went in there and they had to eliminate these creatures in that area. And they talked about, you know, shooting the one, the female, I believe it was. And then Mr. Black confirmed another situation not far from that one where the team went in and they eliminated these creatures. And it's often because there is some kind of more than normal aggressiveness towards people in that area.
What John had told me was that he said, if you spend enough time in Special Forces and you end up on the West Coast, whether it be Alaska or Lewis, a couple of the austere locations, believe it or not, Duckweed Proving Grounds was another one that he told me about. And he said, you get stuck at one of these austere locations or at one of these major installations out in the boonies. And he said, and you spend enough time in group, you're going to end up at some point, you're going to get called in because it's a systematic issue that happens time and time again. It's not an everyday issue. It's not an every week issue. He said, but from time to time, you're going to, at some point in your career, if you spend long enough in group, you're going to end up getting called in and you're going to have to track one of these things. And he said, I'm going to be the first one to tell you. He said, don't go by yourself. He said, rely on your equipment. Make sure that your equipment's working before you leave. Because he said one of the guys that he knew that had a weapons malfunction tracking one of these things, his one of his teammates had gotten nabbed up. Basically, it ripped his arm off. And it ripped his arm off at the shoulder. At that point, I'm kind of looking at him, I'm like, really? And he said, you don't realize how incredibly powerful these things are. You know, a normal mountain gorilla has a strength of 6 grown men. A chimpanzee has a strength of 4 men. He said, these things
much more
have the strength of about 15. If they can rip your arm off at the sockets or, you know, pull your leg off with little to no exertion, that's some real power.
I've told it on the show before, but in 1980 up above Wilkeson, Washington, which isn't really that far from Fort Lewis, two elk were found dismembered up there, and I went to investigate, and this was after game officials had been there and, you know, questioned a friend of mine, which is how I got up there. They found, mushroom pickers had found two elk, and the way the report was written was dismembered without the use of tools. Well, it takes a hell of a lot to pull an elk apart without any kind of tools. And, of course, like Sasquatch tracks and all kinds of stuff up there. But, that's when you see something like that, it really sets it into your mind, the power these things have.
My own experience, I thought the thing was just heavy breathing when it was walking with us back towards the general store. The more I thought about it, I was like, wait a minute. Nothing breathes that heavy because it sounded like it had a respiratory disorder. No, it didn't have a respiratory disorder. The thing was growling at us.
It was growling. You know, it's when you mentioned your brother's account with it baring its teeth, we've heard that a number of times in the past couple of months, too, from other witnesses. And that seems to be a very typical aggressive behavior. It's a challenge behavior.
Well, you know what? He won. Because my little brother wasn't moving out of that park sack.
I wouldn't either. That's one of those what I typically call an underwear-changing moment.
You know, and if I'd have seen details and it was showing me its teeth, okay, you win. I'll leave you alone. But, you know, and of course, in hindsight, there's always that little part of you that wishes that you'd seen a little more, gotten a little more detail. wish you had a flashlight, you know.
It's one of those, you got to be careful what you wish for, though.
Exactly. And, but then again, you kind of think, you know what, maybe God was smiling on me.
You know, I know Wes and Woody probably feel the same way. You know, we've seen things up pretty close. I stood, when I was 16, in front of two of them, less than 15 feet. And I can tell you, I never want to be that close to one again.
Well, we weren't but 20 feet from this thing. Yeah, I mean, it was that close to us.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, which was too damn close. I'd heard that the fella that did the Skookum movie, I heard his interview.
Mike Woolley.
Yeah, Mike Woolley. You know what? With all due respect, Mr. Woolley, I agree with you. Don't point your gun at them because they know what it is. And that's the one thing that my buddy was telling me. He said, they know what a gun is. They're not stupid. Yeah. They absolutely know what a gun is. They may not know how it functions, but they know it goes boom, and they know bad things happen.
I'll tell you what, when I had my first encounter, I knew they knew what the rifle, I was holding a .22, but they knew it was a rifle. And it was actually probably the only thing that saved my bacon, because I was holding the rifle, you know, basically at a port arms position, and I fired a shot just to kind of thinking maybe it would scare it away, and that's when the other one came walking around from behind me. But they didn't attack. They looked pissed off, but they didn't attack, and I took off running. I really think to this day that's kind of what saved me in that situation.
Yeah, well, you know, we had fishing poles, so we were no threat to it unless it thought we were going to whip it to death. You know, like I said, my buddy said, they know exactly what a gun is.
You know, Jack, with your own encounter, it makes you wonder why it didn't attack you that night. Because it sounds like it was on a rampage that night. It sounds like it, you know, went over, killed the cows, knocked the lady down, tried to get her kid. It makes you wonder why it didn't attack you. I realize you guys were 12, 13 years old. I almost wonder if it was the sheer numbers is what kind of kept it from coming after you guys.
And that was the one thing I told my cousin Forrest. I said, if this thing charges us as we're walking backwards, I said, if it charges, everybody go a different direction. Confuse the hell out of it. Because, you know, it won't know which direction to go. You know, I'm grateful it didn't charge us, because it'd be just my luck. It had chased me. It had caught me. I'd have probably been a Tootsie Roll to it. You know what? I'm glad it didn't charge us, because I didn't want to see what it looked like up close. It was close enough as it was. And I talked to some old-timers, like I said, over in East Texas. And as a matter of fact, I had a run-in with Texas and Gulf Coast Bigfoot Research Organization. Most of the guys there are pretty decent guys. They're just basic. They're interested. They want to know what it is. I get that. When I was a cop in the Dallas area. But one of the things that they got one idiot in there that just he actively wants to kill one. And I'm like, what are you going to do when you kill it? You know, you ain't much bigger than a popcorn fart. It's not like you're going to drag it out the woods.
Yeah, surviving what its buddies would do.
Well, and that's just it. And I said, you know, these things don't move by themselves.
That's right. They're
always not
group.
Solitary animals. They're family groups. You better have some serious armament on you. Now, I'm the first one to say I think the only way that it's going to come out is that somebody's going to produce a body. Somebody's going to actually produce a bona fide actual body, and not this bogus BS that's coming out of San Antonio. I shot Bigfoot in my camp. No, it's actually somebody's going to come up with an actual body, liver, spleen, heart, arms, legs, eyeballs, a brain, skeletal structure. They're going to produce a body. But my concern is, how much are they going to pay for that in the long run,
yeah,
producing that one body? Well, and it's just not retribution from his cousins and uncles and aunts and mother and grandmother and grandfather. It's what's going to happen to him from our own federal government.
Our Mr. Black said that the government doesn't care. You can talk about it as much as you want. You can be 100% correct about what you say. He said they only care if you can prove it.
That's it. And they don't want you to prove it. The amount of revenue that's produced in the national parks, in the national forests, is phenomenal. People would be amazed at how much money's produced there.
Oh, we had a federal biologist, right, and he said that the outdoor recreation industry is a $1 trillion annual business.
Exactly. And you know, hunting license would drop overnight.
Well, if the Endangered Species Act kicked in, they'd shut everything down.
Well, and the thing is my retort to that is, really, they can't be that endangered because they're still floating around.
Oh, well, true. I'm not saying that at all, but they would use that, you know, as a pretext for doing all this.
Now, I don't.
Out of the forest.
Me, like yourselves, I believe that these things are extremely dangerous. They can exude a phenomenal amount of violence in a very almost spurt-like action with little to no effort. Most animals that live in the woods they're not known for having good tempers. I would say these creatures do not have a sense of humor at all. And if they do, it's only by chance that they hit, you know, ping somebody in the back of the knot with a rock and knock him down. But they don't want to be coupled with. And my suggestion, don't feed them. For God's sakes, don't feed them. That's like feeding a lion. You know, you're gonna take its natural fear away from you fairly quickly. You start feeding them. And you want to maintain that natural fear, that cautiousness. If you take that away from them, it's not that you're doing the animal injustice. You're doing yourself an injustice because you're putting yourself and possibly family members in danger.
That kind of reminds me of most wild animals in the woods. You know, it's kind of a survival instinct. If they didn't have that, they wouldn't have made it as long as they have so far.
In the wild, there's a common law, survival of the fittest. The one thing that my buddy had said, he said Caesar had said to his fellow Romans, "Vidi, vidi, vici," you know, "I came, I saw, I conquered." And he said, what saved us when we were going after this thing was that we divided and conquered. He said, if you're going to take them on as a group, he said, even an SF team is not going to survive. And most SF teams are 12-man groups. But one against 12 isn't going to survive.
In that particular case, it sounded like with the three, probably three rogue males, you know, when they sort of go out of a group, like near the Browns property, for instance, there's one, maybe another family group in those areas, and they're bonded with each other, the members of family groups, where the rogue males are out, you know, they're kind of loosely connected, but they're looking for females to start their own groups. And it's much easier, I think, to divide those individuals. If you were to attack a family group, those real strong bonds are going to kick in. That would be a lot tougher to surmount that instance.
Well, exactly, and like I talked to Wes earlier, it's a rarity that you see a juvenile, and there's,
right.
You know, I'd ran into people that had actually seen one up in a tree, and said it had leaped tree to tree until it got to about the fourth tree, and then it shimmied down, and he said, you'd be amazed even the small ones have speed, and it didn't take it very long to get out of eyesight.
Going back to Jack's brother, God, can you imagine being in that camper and having this thing go King Kong all over you, and you're just praying for daylight to come? God, that must have been the longest night of those guys' lives, sitting in the back of that camper while this thing's just going off on them. I wanted to ask you, though, Jack, when he spoke with your Special Forces friend, did he ever explain why they went after this creature, why they went and actually killed this creature?
He said that they had gotten called in because there, you know, some people had come up missing, and one person had gotten attacked, and it was right close to Fort Lewis. Whatever it was, or whatever group it was, wasn't a very friendly group, because he said it was, they were, at that one period, they were exceptionally aggressive.
You know, and I'm right kind of on the base out there.
Well, and I'm wondering if, because I had a guy that I'd served as a cop with that was a Marine. He was part of the security force there at Bangor. He told me that he was out one night patrolling the perimeter of the fence at Bangor Naval Station. he had seen something, and it looked like there was three of them. And he feels like the only thing that saved him was that he dived under a pine tree and hid under the boughs of this big pine tree because he thought they were buddies of his, and he screamed at them, and they turned around and looked at him and started walking towards him. And he went around into this tree and then dived underneath this pine tree. And he stayed there a couple hours. Got in trouble for it. He ended up getting captain's mass out of it because they couldn't find him. And he said, you know what? I'll take an ass chewing any day of the week as long as I'm alive. You know, I'll go ahead and do office hours. And I'll gladly do it for a couple of weeks.
I'm not surprised they have people, you know, especially around Lewis, because, and I've told this before, my squad, I was a squad leader with the 5th Air Cav back in the early 80s. My squad ran into one of these things out there one night, and it circled us for a couple hours at least. And I didn't mention anything to the guys, you know, at first. I got a call and said, well, we're not going to have any aggressors out. Just go ahead and have your men practice ambushing or whatever. So I told the team leaders to set the guys up in a classic L-shaped ambush on this road, and we'd practice for a little while and crash out. I took my radio man, and we went into a tree line nearby, and this is when they first come out with the ANPVS-5 night vision goggles. Hmm. And they weren't great, you know, in the beginning. Better than Starlight's Ghost, but not real great. So I was wearing this thing, and I walked into the tree line, and I saw this huge shape in front of me take a step from my right to my left, and my hair just went up. And I started backing up, backed into the poor private. I said, out of the tree line, out, 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 like this. And I hollered for the team leaders to rally the whole squad. I had a 15-man squad on me.
Oh, man.
And the guys, they come running, and I said, okay, I decided I don't want to do any training tonight. We're just going to hunker down and wait till the helicopters come at first light. So I said, everybody get in the 360, and we'll sit here on the road and just, you know, grab some Z's. And pretty soon, one of the guys says, hey, Sergeant, I hear somebody walking around there. And I said, no, there's nobody out here for miles. And then one of the other guys pipes up and says, no, there's somebody walking. I can hear 2 feet walking around us. And one of the guys just jokingly says, hey, maybe it's Bigfoot. And he says, hey, Sarge, you're from here. What do you know about this? So I told him what I'd seen as a teenager. And all the guys would swear up and down that's what was circling us. And, of course, I didn't tell them what I had seen in the
In a tree line, yeah. Well, you know, and the thing is, I don't know that I've had my first duty station was the Old Guard, Washington, D.C., spent 5 years there. Believe it or not, the Old Guard's not totally ceremonial. They actually have a combat unit. You know, it was called Recon Platoon. They were the scouts. And my first job there was ended up riding horses in the cemetery. Which, you know, my dad being my dad and grandfather both being thoroughbred racehorse trainers, they thought that was quite a treat, you know. Even though both of them were Marines and they weren't real happy I joined the Army. But and my grandfather, who just passed away a month ago or a month and a half ago, was actually in the Marines during World War II on Mount Suribachi and watched the flag get raised. They thought that was quite the treat that I was, you know, the Army still got horses, and, you know, and my grandson's riding horses in Arlington National Cemetery. I'm like, it's not all that, trust me. You know, as soon as I get a chance, I'm getting out of this unit. And I ended up going to Recon Platoon. We were doing exavals down at 48D Hill. And I don't know if it was an actual, had a run-in on 48D Hill or not. But it was strange enough that I could see an outline in the trees, and I'm looking at a guy that I'd served with, super nice guy. He grabbed the 203 from me, and he starts walking towards the trees, and then all of a sudden he kind of walks back. He said, let's just stay around the Humvee. And I'm looking at Joey. I'm like, why? He said, let's just stay around the Humvee. Of course, that, you know, shortly thereafter, you know, the rest of our platoon shows up and we assemble, and didn't see anything more that night. But I'd run into some of the range cadres and kind of told them, I said, you know, this happened last night. You know, should we be worried? You know, is there anything out here that we need concerned about? And they said, well, we hesitate to tell you about this one thing, and I knew where it was going. And he said, but on the other hand, we do have SEAL Team 7s over here had built a pretty good size compound right there on Fort A.P. Hill. They trained out of Fort A.P. Hill all the time. For all you know, you could have ran into somebody from SEAL Team 7. And kind of tell you that story, I got to tell you this one. When I was stationed in D.C., I'd ended up going through Marine Corps Sniper School at Quantico. We're out doing one of our final night stalks, and they get permission. One of the teams had gotten broke up, and I'll never forget this Marine's name, Spidey. Super nice guy, really short, though, and he's the proverbial snuffy. If anything's going to happen, it's usually going to happen to him. Well, he gets lost in the woods. He loses his teammate, which is almost grounds for getting, rolled out of the school for. Anyways, apparently the FBI cadets were having a kind of a night function where they were doing night exercises, and they're all kind of sitting around the campfire. They'd already ended their missions, and all of a sudden they see this thing come out of the woods, kind of turn around, look at him, grunt, and go back into the woods. Well, the next morning, of course, we're looking for Spidey everywhere. We can't find him. And we come across this van that says FBI Academy right on the side of it, and they flagged down the gunny that was our cadre, and he gets out, and all of a sudden he starts laughing, and he goes, okay, and he gets back in the van with us, and we're taking off, and said, all right, gunny, what's up? And he said, we think we found Spidey. Really? Yeah, these FBI cadets swore they saw a small Bigfoot come out of the woods and go back into the woods. Well, when you're in a ghillie suit, you look like a damn Sasquatch.
Sure.
You look like a small Sasquatch. So we had quite the rip about that one. I thought that was quite a treat to hear that FBI cadets all swore up and down they saw Bigfoot. But, I can't say definitively that what I saw at Fort APL was a Sasquatch, but I know it was in the wood line. Joey's reaction was very uncharacteristic of his nature, especially coming back saying, well, just stay close to the Humvees. But, and that's the one thing that I would stress to any of the listeners is, if you do come in contact, just try to get out of there the best you can, the safest you can. Kind of keep them confused. And for God's sakes, don't let them get a hold of you. Just listening to that one buddy of mine that I served with in group was more than enough to make me a believer that they get a hold of you, they're going to rip you apart.
Oh yeah.
They're not going to play patty cake with you.
No, by the time
they may play patty cake with your arm,
they're coming after you.
Well, and that's the thing is that he speculated. He said it's either a shortage of food or maybe one is in musk. And I kind of looked at him like, what do you mean one was in musk? And he said, elephants become rogue because they go into musk. That time of the year when they breed, mm-hmm. that they can smell it in the air, but they can't find any satisfaction.
Yeah.
So what do? They go on a rampage. That kind of made sense with me. That really resonated with me. I'm like, okay, that makes sense. Because it's just not elephants do that. Lions do that. Tigers do that. Bears do that. Hell, they'll all kill their own young, not their own offspring, but their own species young, to bring that female back into heat. Why wouldn't, a creature like Bigfoot kill one of us because he's not getting some kind of satisfaction in some way?
There's a guy named Mike Clark, and I think he's in Georgia now, but he was telling me some stories from back in the 70s or early 80s from the Carolinas, where there was one of these creatures in around these farms, and it was killing cattle and horses, and it would take, a big chunk out of their neck of the spine, and they felt that it was killing out of spite. That they really didn't like the people for some reason. Whatever they did, it would kill hogs, it would kill everything.
Well, and that's, when I, like I said, I'd had a run-in with the Texas and Gulf Gulf Coast Bigfoot Research Organization, and they had speculated that, you know, if you do by chance, you know, anger one, they will retaliate. And don't think for a minute that it's just going to be one little time. It's going to be a repetitive thing for a while.
You guys have a real temper you don't want to set off.
There's not much more I can tell anybody other than, you know, be cautious. Don't feed them. For God's sakes, don't make them a pet because they're not a pet. They're ill-tempered. They're vindictive from what I've seen, what I've heard from other people. Treat them with the respect that they deserve. And, you know, don't go up and, it's like I was telling Wes, it wasn't like I was going to go up and shake that dude's hand. He was big.
Tell people to treat him like a bear. Treat him like a bear.
Yeah.
Jack, it's been a pleasure. Thanks for coming on. Thanks for sharing all of your encounters with us. Thanks for sharing all of your stories. I really enjoyed it. And I just really want to thank you for coming on the show tonight.
You bet. You bet. No problem.
That was Jack, everyone. What a fascinating account.
It was an awesome account. And it would be even greater if we could get more current or former Special Forces personnel to come out. And, of course, you know, we'd keep them anonymous, but it would be great to hear some corroborating stories as well. I mean, his was really right in there with the thing Mr. Black has been telling us.
Yeah. No, it was an awesome account. And I want to have him in on the show in the future. He had a lot of other stories that we don't have time to get to tonight, talking about Border Patrol agents that have had run-ins that he knows of personally, that have had run-ins at the border with these creatures. He also has other law enforcement officials that a lot of other stories that we just didn't have time to get to tonight, but I'd love to have him back. I know someone had sent you a encounter, didn't they, Will?
Well, you know, I really, really love some of the details that come out of some of the accounts, and I was sent one earlier today. And it's the person sent it wants to remain anonymous, although I did get permission to put it in my next book, Creek Devil, which is interesting because we get people, you know, who won't come on the show and talk about accounts, but they will give permission as long as I can make it, you know, keep it very anonymous so that no one will find out who they are to use the stories. But getting to the detail, there was an interesting part of this that I'd never heard before, and you and I talked about it, and you'd never heard it either. There was a group of people, you know, to keep the story short, that went on a hike in a western state a number of years back, and the group became separated. One went off to do some exploring, and the other part, two women, didn't want to go where the others went, so they decided to hang around, and it got hot, so they wanted to go down this mountain slope into some shade and wait for the others. And, of course, you know, drinking lots of water when you're hiking, they had to make a nature call, and they stopped by this big boulder they estimated standing next to it was around 9 or 10 feet high. And, you know, one of the women would go around behind the boulder and do her business, and then the other one would come around and they'd take turns. Well, they had seen this creature through some trees above them, and thinking it was a bear, they decided to go down the hill. And when they got down the hill a ways, where they were going to wait, they looked back up at the other side of the boulder, and they saw a shape, a brownish-black, what they thought at first was a rock, at the base of this big boulder, but then it was moving, and it bobbed up and down a bit, and they both saw this. And as they watched this, this boulder, well, the creature now, was nearly to the upper third of this rock, so they estimated it was around 8 feet tall or so, this creature. And what it was doing was sort of bobbing back and forth towards the boulder and then back, and they couldn't quite figure out what it was doing, but they watched it for a while, and then they heard their other companions from up above the ridge calling down for them, and the creature immediately perked up, and then it took off to the right. And some other things happened there, but when the rest of the group started coming down the hill, they stopped by the boulder, and they noticed where the girls had done their nature call, that the dirt was and the urine were sort of mixed together and piled up against the boulder. And I thought that was very strange why, you know, a Sasquatch would do something like that and really don't have an answer for it. And was just kind of curious if any of our listeners out there had ever had a similar encounter or seen anything like that. It's very unusual.
Yeah, it wouldn't be the first odd story we've heard, that's for sure. But, you know, if it's happened once, it's probably happened to someone else.
Exactly. That's why I sort of put it out for the listeners to see if maybe somebody out there has had a similar, you know, encounter or has seen something like that.
Yeah. No, it's a strange one. I know next on the show we have Sam, and Sam had actually sent us his encounter. Sam had kind of an odd encounter. I don't think he actually saw the creature, but you know, Will, we were talking about last week, this chatter and how they mimic people, and Sam does a pretty good impression of the chatter that he heard when he encountered this creature. But I wanted to welcome Sam to the show and have him share his encounter with us.
Hi, Sam. Well, how are you this evening?
Doing well. How are you? Thank you.
Pretty good. Pretty good. Well, let me ask, first of all, how long ago did this incident take place?
This was about 2004. It's been about 10 years ago. Now, it was either 2003 or 2004, and the main reason I don't recollect exactly is because for so long I was, when I asked about it at the time, I was blown off, and I didn't know exactly what I had heard either. So, but it was spring or fall. I do remember that. There was no snow on the ground.
Okay, did you know much about the subject of the Sasquatch prior to that time?
No, not at all, other than seeing the Patterson-Gimlin film as a kid and, you know, Harry and the Hendersons, not really. I'm from Houston, and, you know, the only thing we have down here is dogs and cats, so no, not at all.
That day that this took place, what were you doing?
Yeah, it was about 2 o'clock in the morning, and I was actually asleep, and my father, okay, just to start the story, my father at the time lived in the Black Hills of South Dakota. And this was outside of Lead, about a mile and a half, 2 miles outside of Lead, up on Hearst Mountain. At that time, there was like 3 people that lived on that whole mountain. One road up, one road down. It was very high up. You had to go around a lot of turns just to get up there. And they were the only ones at that time that lived on there. They lived on the corner of the mountain. We had this huge 65-foot deck. But right after the deck, it went straight down, like 45-degree angle, and we were up at treetop level. So just to give you an idea, nobody could actually climb up that except deer. And then in the back of the house, my father had bought like an additional 3 to 5 acres back there just to ensure that one day nobody would build that close to him. I do remember at the time there was logging going on a little bit further down the mountain. You could see it. And now the place is totally built up, and they no longer live there. They live in the Black Hills of Wyoming now. But it's a whole community and neighborhood. But it was about 2 o'clock in the morning. I was asleep on the garage house. It wasn't a separate part of the house. You had to go through the mud room and this other room and then go up the stairs, and there was a room there. And it had 2 windows, one window in front that didn't open, and then one window in the bathroom, which was in the back, and you could open that, and we would open that just to keep it nice and cool. So that window was open, and then the bathroom door was open. And I was asleep, and all of a sudden, I heard this gibberish talk, very loud, and it freaked me up, and I jumped out, and I'll do it for you the best I can do. It went something like this. Just something as ridiculous as that, but it was loud. And I jumped up and I froze. I didn't know what the hell it was, what it could have been. Like I said, I don't know too much about animals. I didn't smell anything. I didn't hear anything, any roars or any crunching of the trees or anything like that. I just heard that. I froze, and honestly, I think I stood there for quite a few minutes. I ended up going back to sleep, you know, maybe half an hour later, and the next morning, I didn't go investigate. I didn't go look. I didn't want to. I was just trying to calm myself down because it really did scare me. The next morning, I asked my parents and even my daughter, who slept on the other side of the house, hey, did you guys hear that last night? And everybody said no, and I told them what I heard, and they kind of laughed at me, blew me off. My stepmom said, well, maybe it was an elk. So years went by, I came back down to Houston, went to work, life went on, blah, 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 and now we live in the wonderful age of YouTube, and I was on YouTube about a year ago, maybe a little bit less, researching everything and that I could find, and just, you know, because I have always been interested in it. I just didn't know anything about it, you know. And I came across Ron Moorhead, one of his videos, and I believe I told Wes that it was the tape recordings were in Wyoming, and that was wrong about that. I went back and looked, and it happens they were in Northern California, but they were verified in Wyoming, at the University of Wyoming, to say that, yes, they're real. There's no other metallic, you know, that can make this metallic plates or whatever they were talking about.
Right.
Yeah, and so that was it. I came across that, and I heard it, and I get goosebumps every single time. I was like, that's what I heard. That's what I heard, and I never heard anything like that before in my life or since. And so, you know, now that I've done more research on it, I know they make similar noises or some, maybe, you know, that kind of gibberish talk. And then I wonder this, now that I've learned a little bit more, maybe it was protesting the fact that we were really encroaching into the hills there. Because, like I said, logging was going on. And, you know, we had built, or my parents had built up there, and there was really nothing up there prior to that. You know, I'm just a speculation, of course, but that's what happened, and that's what I heard.
Well, these guys are kind of short tempers, and I would suspect, like most animals, you know, they get upset, you know, with the encroachment and destruction of a food base,
right.
You know, areas where, you know, they may be currently, you know, raising young or things like that. I mean, there's a lot that's not known about behavior, but
sure.
Oftentimes, you know, they will come in and do these kinds of demonstrations, and it's a challenge, or, you know, they're upset about something.
Right.
I was going to ask you, too, how far from the house do you think that was?
You know, it could not have been more than 15 feet, because the bathroom, you know, it's a very small room. There was the bathroom, window, and then you open the door and it's right there parallel, and then the bed that I was sleeping in was on the wall right next to it, right outside of the bathroom and right on the wall. So I mean, I want to say 10-12 feet, but it couldn't have been more than 15, because, and that's another thing, if there was somebody who was playing a prank, they, number one, they'd have to know I was visiting my dad, and nobody knows me up there. Nobody ever sleeps in that room. I don't know anybody up there. You know, we were just visiting. Number one. Number two, I would have seen something leave or headlights come, because you could see the headlights. And number three, no human that I know of, unless they scream, do that and it be so loud in the bedroom. You know what I mean? It had to have been something with large lungs or just big, it seemed, though, you know.
Did you ever wonder afterwards if maybe, you know, your dad and everyone said they didn't hear anything, but maybe they really did and didn't want to say, you know, anything about what they knew was out there?
No, I don't think so, because I've been on them the past several years about it, and I've shown them what I've heard and talked to them about it, and they still kind of, okay, well, yeah, maybe, you know, no interest or anything at all. You know, I'm 41 years old, so my dad and I, we sit around and have a beer and talk and whatnot, and no, nothing. My stepmother has some involvement. She's an economics person. I don't know what this has to do with it, but she goes to Wind River, Wyoming quite a bit, and I know there's all kinds of sightings that I've heard of over there, and I've asked her as well if she heard anything, and she's just told me no.
Yeah, people in some locations, some regions are pretty closed mouth about things that are going on.
Yeah, I'm sure. You know, my father was born and raised in Chicago and then retired up there. And like I said, when we lived in Houston, so we've been in big cities. So I think even if he had heard something, he wouldn't have even known. You know, they shut everything at night, make sure the dogs are in so that the mountain lions and whatnot, you know, they're pretty much out by 9 o'clock and heavy sleepers. And,
right. So they probably didn't hear anything.
Yeah, and he doesn't go hunting or anything like that where he would have any kind of encounters, you know.
Right. And it may have been just a one-time event, too.
Yeah. Maybe, yeah. I mean, I don't know how to explain it, but I know what I heard, and that's what I heard, and nothing or no one can ever convince me otherwise. I mean, it freaked me out. You know, 10 years later, and right now talking to you, I'm still getting goosebumps. Just that, yeah, I mean, really, really frightened me, the noise.
Yeah, it's very common with, you know, all of us that have seen or heard these things. Mm-hmm. Many years later, I mean, I was 16, you know, 40 years ago when I saw the two creatures I ran into, and whenever I talk about it with someone, you know, occasionally, you know, my skin will go cold and I'll kind of feel like
the back
of my neck is going up.
Bro, exactly how I really feel.
Yeah, you never really get past that.
Right. And then the ones that I hear, the people who've had these experiences, I'm just, you know, I'm completely blown away. And the people that I've talked to, like I said, some of my friends down here, they, you know, I've talked to them now and they laugh at me and whatnot. But I tell them, look, I know what I heard. I don't have anything to gain by you wackadoos laughing at me. And I don't care. I'm thick skin. I'm in my 40s now, it doesn't matter. I know what I heard, and there's been more and more people that have come, you know, credible people as well, you know, park rangers, policemen that didn't say anything for what, 20, 30, 40 years, so people didn't think they were crazy or that they would lose their jobs. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So there has to be something out there. I don't know. Didn't they say there's maybe something about four different types of...
Well, our government insider, Mr. Black, tells us there are four different types.
Yeah. That's what I've heard, and that's what it's, I mean, yeah, it makes sense. You know, it makes sense where we all have different, as humans have different either color skin or different types of hair or different color eyes. Why wouldn't they be a little different as well?
You know, Sam, the impression that you do is money, man. Money in the bank.
Thanks, man. I took a sip of that. I was like, I hope I can do it right for them, but yeah.
It sounds just like Ron Moorhead's tape.
Yeah, that's what I heard, and that's why I'm so convinced. And, you know, I say, of course, oh, I would love to have an encounter. And then, of course, you have to, you know, be careful what you wish for. These aren't little
<right.
laughs> Ewoks or cuddly bears, you know.
Yeah, they are not that.
But just because I'm absolutely fascinated by it. And I listen to you guys, and I listen to your shows every night. Before, it was always, you know, whatever music I was listening to go to bed, and now it's your show in my ears as I go to sleep. And that's been the running occurrence lately. And I just can't get enough, you know.
Well, I hope we're not making nightmares.
No, I'm enthralled by it. But the only one that makes me mad, I think, is like the Rick Dyers, you know, those guys that make a mockery. It seems to put everything back, gives the naysayers even more ammunition.
Right, and there's so much of that junk out there.
He came through Houston with the supposedly dead body and charged people $20 a hit to go and look at it. And
oh, yeah.
I think a couple of weeks later, he said, oh, no, it's a fool.
Well, I feel sorry for the people that paid money for that.
Yeah, me too. You know.
I know we're getting low on time, but, Sam, I'm fascinated by it. I'm fascinated by the chatter stories. I'm just fascinated by this chatter that people keep reporting.
Is that what they refer to as a samurai chatter I've heard, or is that something different?
I think that's it, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, and I wonder how come, you know, it, honestly, I wanted to say, well, I wish it roared. No, I'm glad it didn't, because that would have, I was already scared. Honestly, I won't lie, like a little girl. I was like, oh, my God, and I jumped up and I froze, you know, 30-year-old grown man. But whatever that noise was scared me to death.
That's right, a roar could have been your underwear changing moment.
Yeah, absolutely. Imagine how even much louder that could have been. But yeah, that was it. That's all that happened. I wish there was more, really, but that was it. And I'll never forget it.
Yeah, you never forget it. You definitely never forget it. Sam, thank you so much for being on the show. I want to thank Jack for being on the show. Will Woody, it looks like number 45 is down. Until next week, everyone, have a great night.